Good morning. We wish a Merry Christmas and welcome you all in the morning English worship. Kindly follow the C.S.I Book of Common Order of Worship, page number 43. Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace among those whom He favors. Do not be afraid, for see, I am bringing you good news of great joy for all the people. To you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is the Messiah, the Lord. For a child has been born for us, a son given to us. Authority rests upon his shoulders, and he is named Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Let us pray. Page number 49. Praise be to you, O God the Father, who created all things by your power and wisdom, and loved the world so as to give your Son to be our Savior. Praise be to you, O God the Son, who was made human-like as in all things, except sin, and was delivered for our offenses, and raised again for our justification. Praise be to you, O God the Holy Spirit, who does lead us into all truth, and does shed abroad the love of God in our hearts. All praise and glory be to you, O God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, forever and ever. Amen. Please be seated. Let us all rise and sing the hymn number 30, hymn number 30, Hark the Herald Angels Sing.
The responsive reading is taken from Psalm 85 verses 8 to 13. Psalm 85 verses 8 to 13. Let me hear what God the Lord will speak, for He will speak peace to His people, to His faithful, to those who turn to Him in their hearts.
Surely salvation is at hand for those who fear Him. There is glory made well in our land.
Steadfast love and faithfulness will meet. Righteousness and peace will kiss each other.
Faithfulness will spring up from the ground, and righteousness will look down from the sky.
The Lord will give what is good, and our land will yield its increase. Righteousness will go before Him, and will make a path for His steps.
Please turn page number 50 for the confession prayer. Page number 50. If we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, He who is faithful and just will forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. I will get up and go to my Father, and I will say to Him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before You. I am no longer worthy to be called Your son. The time is fulfilled, and the kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe in the good news. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but we have one who is every respect has been tested as we are, yet without sin. Let us kneel and examine ourselves in silence. Let us humbly confess our sins to the Almighty God. Let us say together the confession, following confession prayer. Almighty and most merciful God, we are guided and strayed from Your ways like lost sheep. We have followed too much the devices and desires of our own hearts. We have offended against Your holy laws. We have left undone those things which we should have done, and we have done those things which we should not have done. And there is no health in us, but You, O Lord, have mercy upon us, miserable among us. Spare them, O God, who confess their faults. Restore them that are penitent according to Your promises, declared to humankind in Christ Jesus our Lord. And grant, O most merciful God, for His sake, that we may hereafter live a godly, righteous, and just life, to the glory of Your holy name. Amen. May the Almighty and merciful Lord grant us pardon and remission for all our sins, time for amendment of life, and the grace and comfort of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Please be seated. Friends, today our preacher is Dr. Satya Sudhir, architect and author, 100 Red Roses, Bangalore. On behalf of the congregation, the pastors and the church committee, we welcome you in our midst. Now we'll have the special song by the four-tone, followed by the ministry of the Word of God. After that, the preacher will deliver God's message.
The true meaning of this Christmas is about the cross. It's about the Jesus Christ who died for our sins. It is not just about the gifts and lights. Yes, of course, we love to celebrate, but think about it a little. Did Jesus born in our lives? Did we invite him in our hearts? Are we giving enough time for him more than anyone in this world? Do we really love Jesus our Savior? If it is so, then why are we still living in the darkness of lust, pride, ego, greedy, secret sins, sexual immorality, spineless, double-minded, cursing, malice, arrogance, folly, selfish ambition, fight, hatred, unthankful, unholy, unforgiving, and the list goes on and on. Now it's time to give our whole heart to the Lord Jesus Christ. Let's start our day by truly celebrating his salvation, by receiving it ourselves, and then share the good news to everyone. 1 John 1:16 says, if we claim to have fellowship with him and yet walk in the darkness, we lie and do not live out of the truth. Now as we forgive ourselves, as we submit ourselves to the Lord, let's sing A Ray of Hope and Zion's Daughter.
Waiting for one child, black, white, yellow, no one knows. But the child that will grow up and turns tears to laughter, hate to love, walk to peace, and everyone's to everyone's neighbor, and misery will, suffering will be, words to be forgotten forever.
A rosy hue settles all around. You've got no fear. Your own solid ground. For a spell or two, no one seems so low. This comes to pass when a child is born. It's all a dream, an illusion now. It must come true, sometime soon, somehow. Child is born. This comes to pass when a child is born.
Smile, holding in your arms the Christ.
Him had happened, that I brought the Savior near. Now my hope starts rising for another day, with eternal love and justice finally on the way. Zion's daughter, now your heart is full of joy. In a cradle in the manger lies the Holy Boy. Zion's daughter, with your sweet angelic smile, holding in your arms the Christ child, resting for a while. Shining in a wondrous glow. Now the world is waiting, people want to hear what in Bethlehem had happened, that all will see you near. Zion's daughter, now your heart is full of joy. Cradle in the manger lies the Holy Boy. Zion's daughter, with your sweet angelic smile, holding in your arms the Christ child, resting for a while.
The Old Testament reading is taken from the book of Isaiah, chapter 9, verses 2 to 7. Isaiah, chapter 9, verses 2 to 7. The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who dwelt in the land of deep darkness, on them has light shone. You have multiplied the nation. You have increased its joy. They rejoice before you as with joy at the harvest, as they are glad when they divide the spoil, for the yoke of his burden and the staff for his shoulder. The rod of his oppressor you have broken as on the days of Midian. For every boot of the trampling warrior in battle tumult and every garment rolled in blood will be burned as fuel for the fire. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder. And his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and of peace, there will be no end on the throne of David and over his kingdom, to establish it and to uphold it with justice and with righteousness from this time forth and forevermore. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will do this. These are the words of the Lord. Glory be to the Lord Jesus Christ.
The lesson for the epistle reading is taken from the epistle of Paul, the apostle to the Ephesians, chapter 1, 3 to 14. Ephesians 1, 3 to 14. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places in Christ, just as he chose us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and without blame before him in love, having predestined us to adoption as sons by Jesus Christ to himself, according to the good pleasure of his will, to the praise of the glory of his grace, by which he has made us accepted in the Beloved. In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins, according to the riches of his grace, which he made to abound towards us in all wisdom and prudence, having made known us known to us the mystery of his will, according to his good pleasure, which he purposed in himself, that in the dispensation of the fullness of times he might gather together in one all things in Christ, both which are in heaven and which are on earth, in him, in whom also we have obtained an inheritance, being predestined according to the purpose of him who works all things according to the counsel of his will, that we who first trusted in Christ should be to the praise of his glory. In him you also trusted after you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, in whom also having believed, you were sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise, who is the guarantee of the inheritance until the redemption of the purchased possession to the praise of his glory. This is the lesson. Glory to God.
I request the congregation to rise up for the gospel reading. The gospel reading is taken from Luke chapter 2 verses 1 to 14. Luke chapter 2 verses 1 to 14. In those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that a census should be taken of the entire Roman world. This was the first census that took place while Quirinius was governor of Syria. And everyone went to his own town to register. So Joseph also went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to Bethlehem, the town of David, because he belonged to the house and line of David. He went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for the baby to be born, and she gave birth to her firstborn, a son. She wrapped him in cloths and placed him in a manger because there was no room for them in the inn. And there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is Christ the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger." Suddenly, a great company of the heavenly host appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to men on whom his favor rests." Glory be to the God.
Let's pray. O come to my heart, Lord Jesus. There is room in my heart for thee. Amen. Please be seated. I would like to wish each and every one of you in the congregation today a Merry Christmas. And I hope that the Prince of Peace, our Lord Jesus Christ, will bring peace not only in your homes, but also in your hearts this Christmas. I would like to thank the three readers of the Bible reading. They are the forerunners to this message, and they read it very nicely, very clearly. Miss Jenny, Miss Annie, and Mrs. Aslin, thank you for reading the Bible as a forerunner to my message. I'm somebody who loves gospel singing, so I totally enjoyed both the songs that the group Four Tones sang. I think you are a family. And Geeta Auntie is a very close friend of our family, so I really enjoyed your song. Two songs, beautiful numbers, When a Child is Born and Zion's Daughter. So thank you so much. Remember that one of Jesus' hobbies was singing, and he often sang with the disciples as they went to the Mount of Olives. So please continue singing as a family that sings together, stays together. Now let's turn our thoughts and our hearts to today's message. If you take your pew slip, right at the top, you have the topic given for today's message. That is Christmas, finding space for the Prince of Peace. And just to help us understand this topic a little better, I thought I would tell you a little story, a well-known story. Probably most of you know it. It's the story of the Arab and the camel. Now, like all good stories start, long, long ago in a land far away, an Arab was traveling across the desert with his beloved camel. And because it was becoming close to night, he decided to pitch his tent and settle down and have a good night's rest for the next day. He pitched his tent. It was just right. It was the right size for him. So he started to sleep. Now through a small gap in the tent door, the camel stuck its head inside and said, "Oh master, the desert wind is so cold, it is affecting my nose, it's affecting my ears. I'm not able to sleep. You alone are sleeping nicely inside the tent. Please let me put my head inside your tent." So now the master said, "No harm in letting the camel put its head inside the tent. Anyway, I am comfortably sleeping." So the master said, "Okay." And he went back to sleep. After some time, the camel again awoke the Arab and said, "My head is nothing without my neck. Can I please put my neck also inside the tent?" So the master said, "Okay." He was very sleepy. He said, "Okay." So now the camel put its head and its neck inside the tent. Now the master started snoring. He was sleeping nicely. Again, he was awakened by the camel. And the camel said, "Is it fair that just my head and my neck are inside the tent? Let me put my four legs inside your tent." Now the master was really sleepy, so he just nodded, "Okay, okay." And the camel comfortably put its four legs inside the tent. After 10 minutes, the camel again awakened the master and said, "Master, you alone are sleeping comfortably inside the tent. Let me also sleep inside the tent. I'll bring my hind legs also inside." And before the master could say yes or no, the camel had very quickly parked itself inside the tent. Now you can imagine what happened. The camel was inside the tent and the Arab was thrown outside the tent into the cold desert wind. Now the master was very angry. The Arab was very angry. He wrapped up his tent and he said, "I can bear the cold desert wind. Let's continue on our journey." Now this is just a simple lesson that I read in my daughter's moral science book. But if you draw a parallel to today's message, it has a deeper meaning. The Arab in the story represents our Lord Jesus Christ. And the tent in the story represents our lives, our hearts. And the place we have given to Jesus this Christmas, we are calling him the Prince of Peace. And the camel in the story represents the many distractions of Christmas, which have taken away the space that we had kept for Jesus in this Christmas. Just to understand this topic a little better, I'll come back to the story. Let's split up our topic. It says Christmas, finding space for the Prince of Peace. Let's take the word peace. We all know what peace is. We say Samadhanam in Tamil. We say Nimadi in Tamil. We say Shalom in Hebrew. And I often ask my husband every birthday, "What do you want for your birthday?" He'll say, "Yen penjadi nimmadiya irunda, I am happy." So all of us want peace in our lives. We want a peaceful home. We want a peaceful job. We want peace, a peaceful boss. We want a peaceful neighborhood to live in. Nobody wants to live in the midst of a war. And especially in today's context, all of us are looking for world peace. We want peace in Israel. We want peace between Russia and Ukraine. Especially, you know, my husband works in transportation. He wants all the wars to end so that the ships can sail easily. And we want peace between India and Pakistan, India and China. All of us have that longing for peace. Even in the Bible, every king, his success was determined by the number of years there was peace in that land. If you take Judges chapter 3 verse 11, you'll find that king's rule, there was peace in the land for 40 years, or right through 1 Kings, 2 Kings, peace in Israel for 20 years, 80 years, all that was marks of success. And my favorite king in the Bible, Jehoshaphat ruled in peace because God gave him security. in 2 Chronicles chapter 20 verse 30. So for most of us, we know what peace is. Peace means something still, something calm. It is the absence of a storm. But for a Christian, peace should not mean the absence of a storm. It should mean the presence of God in that storm. That is what Christian peace is. So now we have a good understanding of the word peace. Let's move on to Prince of Peace. Who is this Prince of Peace? No brownie points for guessing that. It's Jesus himself. He was born this Christmas day, many years, 2,000 years ago. And who called him the Prince of Peace first? Our Old Testament reading gave us the answer. It is the prophet Isaiah. Most of us read Isaiah chapter 9 during Christmas, but I would urge you to read Isaiah chapter 8 to understand why Isaiah prophesied this prophecy. At that time, Israel was in sin. You know, this prophet Isaiah prophesied in 700 BC. At that time, the life of the Israelites was steeped in sin. And because of sin, God decided these people all tani telchekes. So let's bring the enemies to oppress them, to defeat them, and to take away their land. So God did that, and their land was taken away. They were oppressed. They were taken as slaves. And in their anguish, they cried out to the Lord. And so, in the Old Test, as we read in the Old Testament lesson, God promised a Savior who would deliver them from their sins and hence deliver them from their enemies. God promised, I'm reading from the Bible, God promised them a Savior in verse 6. A child is born to us, a son, a prince is given, and he will be called Wonderful, Prince of Peace. Now, why wasn't Jesus called King of Peace? Why was he called Prince of Peace? The answer is very simple, because God the Father is the King, the maker of the universe. His son is Jesus, and hence the son of a king is called Prince, Prince of Peace. And this son would deliver people from their sins and give them peace. Very simple. And Jesus himself, he was a personification of peace. He used the word peace 23 times in his ministry. He told his disciples, "My peace I give to you." And even after his resurrection, he kept on saying, "Peace be with you. Let my peace be with you." Now, this plan of God to bring Jesus into the world as the Prince of Peace was predestined. It was not just an on-the-spot decision. It was predestined. That's what we read in the epistle lesson from Ephesians chapter 1, verses 3 to 14. God had planned to set all mankind free many, many years ago. And this plan of God was to send his own son through a lowly birth to the whole world to bring peace on earth among mankind, to bring peace among men, and most importantly, peace in our hearts. Today that is missing in many of our hearts. We are rich, we have everything, we have family, we have a home, we have a car, but many people do not have peace in their hearts. And how did God the Father bring this peace to all mankind? He went to the lowly shepherds, as we read in the gospel lesson. The angels came to the lowly shepherds and sang, "Glory to God in the highest, and peace on earth to those with whom he is pleased." God gives that peace to those with whom he is pleased only, not to everyone. Now comes the third part. Finding space for the Prince of Peace. What does that mean? Very simple. It means our response to Jesus being born as the Prince of Peace. I would like to ask you a question. Are you finding space for this Prince of Peace in your life this Christmas? Perhaps this morning, before we did our Bible reading, we took our mobiles and sent WhatsApp messages to everybody. We have pushed out Jesus and we have found space for our mobile. In those days when we sleep, my mother used to keep the Bible under our pillow. But no longer people keep their Bibles under their pillows. They keep their mobile phones. But so important to know who's trying to contact me and who I have to contact. Just like how the camel pushed the Arab out of the tent, today we are no longer finding space for this Prince of Peace. We have pushed out Jesus and brought in all other distractions. Maybe in your home you moved a little furniture in your living room, in your dining room, and brought in a Christmas tree. Maybe you moved along your work schedules and made time, you made space to come to Nagercoil city like us because you want to celebrate Christmas with your family. Maybe you moved along your diet plans, all your diabetes pills, sugar plans, everything pushed aside so that you can make space to have a nice Christmas biryani and payasam afterwards. But have you made space in your heart for that Prince of Peace? Is there room in your heart for Jesus? Now let me come back to that camel and Arab story. The way the camel pushed itself into the tent and found its space in the tent and pushed the Arab out, very slowly, many distractions in our life have come into our lives and our hearts and have pushed Jesus out of Christmas. Are we really finding space for Jesus, or is everything else about Christmas finding space in our hearts? The very first Christmas had no Christmas tree, had no Christmas lights. It, as you can see in our Christmas cards, it was a picture-perfect representation of Christmas. You have Mary and Joseph sitting with the baby Jesus in a manger, sometimes wearing well-stitched clothes. Jesus is wearing beautiful clothes in that Christmas card. And then you have the lowly shepherds and the wise men on bended knee. But as years went by, we brought in secularism into our Christmas. We have found space for secularism and pushed Jesus, just like how the camel pushed the Arab a little bit, we have pushed Jesus to a corner. We put up our Christmas tree. Most of our Christmas trees have bells, we have angels, we have balls, all different color balls. Do we even know what those balls represent? Why do we hang bells? Why do we hang reindeer? We don't have reindeers in India. We have horses and donkeys and cows. Probably in the present government, it would be more appropriate to hang cows on our Christmas tree. Why do we hang reindeers? It's meaningless to our Christmas. But we still do it. Blindly, we have pushed Jesus aside and brought in distractions into our Christmas. Distractions have found space in our Christmas, and we have pushed this Prince of Peace aside. Most of our festivities have brought in consumerism into our Christmas. First was secularism, then comes consumerism. We are more interested in buying the most beautiful stars to hang in our tree. From the first week of December, we are decorating our homes. How much time do we spend at the Lord's feet? Are we spending time saying, Lord, this Christmas, come into my heart and make a change in my life? Or are we busy putting up our tree and decorating our house? Many houses have about 40 stars, you know, different colors, different sizes, all patterns. We have brought in consumerism into our Christmas. And just like the camel quietly brought its neck and forelegs in and pushed the Arab to the corner, we have brought consumerism and pushed Jesus aside. And friends, the worst of all is commercialism. Today, we, CSI Christians, we call ourselves Protestants. Why? Because we protested against the Catholic Church and we wanted to break away from Catholics. You know why? Because we said Catholics have statues, Catholics have feasts, Catholics have saints. Now, we said nobody is a saint except the apostles and Paul. But what have we done, Protestants? We brought Mr. Saint Nicholas into our Christmas, the worst thing that can happen to our Christmas. And we have given him a nickname, Santa Claus, not realizing that Santa Claus is an anagram of Satan Lucas. And Lucas is a short form for Lucifer. Just like how the camel pushed itself completely into the tent and pushed the Arab out, today, in most of our Christmases, Santa Claus is the hero and Jesus has been pushed away. It is most annoying for me to see carol rounds coming to our home singing Hark the Herald or O Little Town of Bethlehem, and then there's a man dancing like Santa Claus. And I'm very tempted to ask those carolers, where is Jesus? Who is this Santa Claus? He's not mentioned in the Bible. He has no place in your Christmas. He's a Catholic saint. And even his history is not mentioned anywhere in Google. I challenge anyone in the congregation to find me a full record of Santa Claus. we have pushed out Jesus and brought in Santa Claus as our main mascot for Christmas. If you go to Pothys or any of the shopping malls in town, you won't find Jesus this Christmas. You will find Santa Claus. Even in our own homes, our Christmas tree is full of Santa Claus. We dress up our children with Santa hats. Why not dress up our children as Jesus? When we go caroling, why don't we dress up our carolers as Mary and Joseph with a little baby and spread the good news of Christmas, this Prince of Peace, to the whole world? We accuse all our Hindu friends of bringing statues and imposters into Christianity. We say they are opposing us. It is not the truth. We Christians, we Protestants have brought an imposter into our Christmas. We have pushed out Jesus, this Prince of Peace, and brought in the camel called Santa Claus and all our distractions. And what is the result? Every Christmas goes by, 2000, 2001, 2002. Can you remember a wonderful Christmas when this Prince of Peace came into your heart and changed your life? It's all because Jesus has just taken a small portion in our Christmas. He has been pushed to the corner. Where is Jesus this Christmas? Have you found space for this Prince of Peace? Dear friends, I'm somebody who can testify to the fact that peace in your heart is the most important in the world. I was somebody who did not have peace for many years because of happenings around my life. But when I surrendered my life to the Lord Jesus Christ, He gave me a peace that passeth all understanding, a peace that transcends all. It's a peace that only Jesus, this Prince of Peace, can give in your heart. Now, the good news is this peace is free. It's available to all. You have a lifetime subscription to peace. There's no validity period. It's no expiry date. It's a lifetime subscription and it's free. All you have to do is say, Lord Jesus, this Christmas, I'm going to find space in my heart, in my home, in my family for you, because you are the Prince of Peace. And what happens if you do that? You will be joyful. It's a joy that the world cannot give. That's what we read in the gospel lesson in Luke. Luke chapter 2 verse 20. When the shepherds went, they found space in their busy schedule. They went to the manger. They found the Prince of Peace. And do you know what the shepherds did? They came back praising, singing praises to God. And the same with the wise men. In Matthew chapter 2 verse 10, we find that the wise men were overjoyed. So when you find space for the Prince of Peace, your life will be filled with joy. Dear friends, today in many foreign countries, especially the US, I'm a little familiar with that. So the US, God has been removed from schools because people feel that public schools should give freedom to children to choose their own religion, to choose their own path of life. So when 9/11 happened and the Twin Towers came crashing down, there was an interview with Billy Graham's daughter, Anne Graham. I really liked that interview, so I would like to read an excerpt from that. So the interviewer asked Anne Graham, if God is so good, why did God let 9/11 happen to America? As you know, in every dollar, it's written, in God we trust. Then why did 9/11 happen? Why did the terrorists attack America? And she had a classic reply. She said, for some years now, we have no space for the Prince of Peace. We have decided to push him aside to a corner. Americans have shaken their fist at God and told God, there is no way we can find space for you in our schools, no space for you in our government. We want to separate state and church. There's no space for you in our business. If you go to any business office in the US, you will not find a cross. There's no space for God in our workplace. And do you know what? God is a perfect gentleman. He will never force himself in where he's not wanted. God has quietly backed out of our national, political, and public life. He not only removed himself, but he also took away his hand of blessing and protection. Friends, this Christmas, please remember the Arab and the camel story. How slowly, conveniently, without any notice, the camel found its space into the tent and pushed the Arab out. Let's remember that story and ponder in our hearts, are we doing the same to Jesus? Are we slowly bringing in all the festivities of Christmas? Are we bringing in all the distractions around us? Are we bringing this imposter Santa Claus into our Christmas and pushing poor Jesus out? Many homes, we don't even have a manger, but we have a Christmas tree and we have all the decorations. Where is the space for Jesus? Let's go back home today and spend time in prayer. Let's spend time with that Prince of Peace, because if he comes into your heart, you will be overjoyed like the shepherds and the wise men. Let's pray the same prayer that we prayed at the beginning of the sermon. Oh, come to my heart, Lord Jesus. There is room in my heart for thee. The collect that has been written for today on page 2 of the pew slip summarizes today's message very nicely. So when pastor reads it, please read it and pray with a lot of meaning, because the words say, make our hearts humble enough to offer space for the Prince of Peace, so that we may experience and share the good news of your salvation to all.
Now the time for baptism. I request the parents, please come forward with your children.
Dearly beloved, we are gathered together to administer holy baptism to these children, that according to Christ's command, they may be sealed as members of Christ, children of God, and heirs of the kingdom of heaven. Hear therefore the words of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything that I have commanded you. And remember, I am with you always to the end of the age. Here also what is written in the Gospel according to St. Mark. People were bringing little children to him in order that he might touch them. And the disciples spoke sternly to them. But when Jesus saw this, he was indignant and said to them, let the little children come to me. Do not stop them, for it is to such as this that the kingdom of God belongs. Truly I tell you, whoever does not receive the kingdom of God as a little child will never enter it. And he took them up in his arms, laid his hands on them, and blessed them. Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. He loves children and is ready to receive them, to embrace them with his merciful arms. And then we can with confidence pray that he will grant them the gift which will enable them to grow up as his own sons and daughters, and will give them the blessings of eternal life. It is the duty of those who present children for baptism to make a confession of a faith in which they are baptized and to promise to bring them up in the way of Christ. Do you believe and trust in God, the Father Almighty, who created heaven and earth? Do you believe and trust in Jesus Christ, the Son of God, who for our salvation died on a cross, was raised from the dead, lives now in glory as a Savior and Lord of all, and will come again to judge the living and the dead? Do you believe and trust in the Holy Spirit of God, who renews, guides, and strengthens the people of God? Let us all rise up and affirm our faith according to the words of Apostle Creed, page number 56. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Church, please be seated.
Do you who have brought these children for baptism promise before God and in the presence of this congregation that you will yourself steadfastly affirm and uphold the faith of the church? Do you promise that by your prayers for these children, by your own manner of life, and by your guidance, you will help them as they grow to pray and to worship God, to study the Bible, to follow the example and teaching of the Lord Jesus Christ, to share generously what they have with others, and to take an active part in the church's witness to Christ? Do you promise that you will help these children to grow in the knowledge and experience of Christ and encourage them later to be received into the full fellowship of the church by confirmation, so that established in faith by the Holy Spirit, they may partake of the Lord's Supper and go forth into the world to serve God faithfully in His church?
Let us pray. O holy and loving God, your word became flesh so that in union with him, all people may be enabled to be your children. Accept these children, we pray, and make them your own in the body of Christ. Send your Holy Spirit and sanctify this water, that as water cleanses, refreshes the body, so these children now to be baptized in this water may be born anew and may have the blessing of eternal life in Jesus Christ our Lord, who with you, O Father, and with the Holy Spirit lives and reigns to the end of the ages. Amen. Let us pray. Almighty and gracious God, in your mercy you have called all people to enter into your kingdom through the redeeming work of Christ, our Savior. We thank you for making these children
You won this day through baptism by giving them a new birth in water and the Holy Spirit and making them a member of the body of Christ. Guide, strengthen, and sanctify them all the days of their lives. Enable them, their parents, to fulfill the promises they have made, so that under their care, these children may grow up in the knowledge of your love, in devotion to you, through Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, in wisdom, power, and love, we offer thanks and praise now and always. Amen.
Let us all rise up and sing a song. Begins, O come, all ye faithful. Hymn number 31. Hymn number 31.
Please be seated.
The intercession prayer is taken from the C.S.I. Book of Common Worship, page number 81. For all the Christian churches throughout the world, that the love and peace sown in Christ Jesus may animate them and flow through them into the world, we pray, Come Spirit of love, fill us with your power. For all the people of different faiths and beliefs in the world, that they may be instruments of love, peace and unity among nations, and a source of hope and strength for the suffering and oppressed, we pray, Come, Spirit of love, guide us. For all those who have been marginalized in this world, those who have been deliberately and forcibly prevented from sharing in the goods of God's providence, that they may find hope and strength to transform God's creation, we pray, come Spirit of love, transform us. For all the women of the world who have been made victims of unjust wages, overwork and various forms of harassment, that they may demand and attain the equality due to the children of God, we pray, come Spirit of love, comfort us. For all those who are suffering from character assassination, psychological stress, painful and terminal illnesses, that they may find support and strength, we pray, come Spirit of love, heal us. For all pastors and social workers, for those who study and teach theology, that their labors may be grounded in commitment to the unity of churches, love of neighbor, and concern for justice, we pray, come Spirit of love, encourage us. For those areas of our world where conflict and warfare rage, especially that those working for peace and justice may not lose heart, we pray, come Spirit of love, reconcile us. For all martyrs, those who have been laid down their lives for the sake of others and struggle for a new way of life in the service of peace, for those who have died due to indifference, apathy and corruption, that the dangerous memory of their deaths may inspire us, speak the truth powerfully, we pray, come Spirit of love, inspire us. To you, God, our parent, our source of life, we lift up these prayers and these hopes through him who has revealed the reality of divine love and the possibility of human love, Jesus our Lord, brother and friend. Amen.
Page number 86. Let us say together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, holy be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom, the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. The Creator, Redeemer and Sustainer, who became a human being to be born in a virgin and laid in a manger, to live as Emmanuel, to be obedient even unto the death upon the cross, make our hearts humble enough to offer space for the Prince of Peace, so that we may experience and share the good news of your salvation for all. Through Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forevermore. Amen.
May the God of love, who shared his love, strengthen us in our love for others. May the Son, who shared his life, grant us grace that we might share our life. And may the Holy Spirit indwelling us empower us to be only and always for this. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also be with you.
Let us depart in peace.